father and mothers for frustration, they took this of this place. And this is just a continuous of the lectures from yesterday, trying to find a way to improve the purpose of this way that can show the video rates immediately. And you can see that the motivation of this work is driven by the video rate, the video rate LCDs, and certainly I think there are multiple ways to do to achieve this. It has been achieved by electronic methods. One of the major issues related to current LCDs, mostly is the beam angle, contrast ratios, you know, color image, color quality, has been improved. In addition to that, the industry evolved to producing low cost, low cost TV panels, for example, right now, the 55-inch, very high-quality, 120Hz driven panels cost roughly around $1,200, maybe between $1,200 and $1,500. But if you want to have a 3D application, switching from 3D to 3D, you just add about $100, that depends on which technology that you're looking for. You choose either the pattern within retarders, or choose for these glasses. There are two different types, but still, I think the resolution, brightness, is an issue for 3D, so there are also rooms to improve. But for current TV applications, I think you do see that, just trying to get used to this PowerPoint presenter. You can see in the case of 25 millisecond response time, an image will look like this, the fish. This tomato clown fish, the clown fish was swimming, and you can see the exploded image. But if you have some switching response time less than a few milliseconds, for example, a couple of milliseconds, and you can have a very clear still image of this fish swimming around. But if you are watching this baseball, for example, 25 milliseconds, you can see that the blurred image of the impact between the ball and the bat. But for fast switching, you can see clearly the image of this ball coming in, caused by, pitched by the pitcher, and then hit by the hitter. You can see everything in clear motion. So those were the motivation behind this. There are ways to do this, as I say, electronically. They can drive this device in a higher frame rate, for example, from 120 to 240. In the future, can increase up to 480. I think sooner you will see that on the market. The other methods to improve this this frame rate by scaling back light, so they can use this color sequential methods to switch this three different colors. And then in addition to that, they can use some of this black insertion to solve this color break. Otherwise, you will see different colors breaking up. But still, all the technology of this improving this video rate LCD technology relies on the improvements in materials. So in this case, we work on a different type of approach. We use a surface polymer assisted this liquid crystal alignment to achieve fast switching. In addition to that, is reduce this light scattering, because if you put the polymer between two substrates, you're going to create some kind of indices matching between polymer and liquid crystal. So you're going to create some kind of light scattering at off angles in some cases. That's going to reduce this transmission. So we will work on, so in this case, that I show you that how a function of polymer that can improve this. This type of composite materials. And then in the basic introductory, I show you that some of the morphology comparison, the inference of polymer network on its optical properties, and then later on we'll talk about the display applications. So the first question you may want to ask, if you put the mixtures of homogeneous mixtures, liquid crystal and monomer with some photocatalyst, mixtures of those, putting in a little crystal as a gas. What that line means is that the concentration of this material is probably around less than 10%. And then how do you prepare this material to localize on the surface instead of like building the polymer fibers in between two substrates? So one of the examples over here, you can see that, for example, one of the pneumatic liquid crystal holds roughly around 95%. And then we have these reactive monomers that is a mesogenic-like structure and the spaces between two polymerized alkylate groups. And then certainly you need a small amount of these polymer catalysts. So under the illumination of UV, these polymer catalysts can break up the bond between these two carbon and then generate two electrons. So in that case, that the free energy of this system is high, and then so there are this chemical energy of this system is high, and when these radicals find a double bonds, they will give away those electrons and producing those continuous free chain end and continue to grow. So the phase separation can be explained using this scheme over here. First of all, you have this monomer and liquid crystal mixtures in a uniform state. And after you shine a light on this system, you can see that they start to form seeds to nucleate. The size start to grow. And the growth of those is a polymer beads or polymer gradients. It can start from the defect area. If you have a surface defect area, or if you have spaces. So they can start from those areas and start to connect. Once the critical mass reaches to some extent, then they can continue to grow to the size. You can see that this SCM morphology kind of building those granules in very uniform spacing. You can see that this is about 1 micron bar here. And then so those particles can grow in sub-micron size. This the size of this nodule of beads, or whatever how you want to call them, is proportional to certainly the temperature of this production of this type of material, and then inverse proportional to this reaction of this forming this particle. So this reaction, certainly the viscosity of the system, is very important. And then this reaction of the system is certainly proportional to the concentration of the reactive monomer, and then the light intensity that you use to produce this induce this phase separation. The quantum yield, certainly the quantum yield of the your catalyst that long the life of your residence of life. So the gamma here in the liquid crystal system, it creates an anisotropy of absorption. So that's kind of a unique system that you will find nowhere in the isotopic solution. So in addition to that, certainly the photoinjected concentration and the pass length, the pass length means the cell gap. The thickness of your sample is also critical issues that how do you form this and how much you will form. So this is a kind of example. In general, if you don't control anything, the rate of reaction is kind of proportional to whatever rate of formulation. And that rate of formulation is certainly governed by different factors. Well, if there's an anisotropy in the system, it may cause some kind of anisotropy absorption of incident light. Modification to be introduced to KPs, so there's a kind of a rate of formulation parallel to this liquid crystal direct orientation or perpendicular to the liquid crystal direct orientation. So in that case, that if you have some kind of planar alignment, you might create some kind of a planar type of this orientation of this form of fiber. So as we say that in general, this type of materials produced with monomer concentration less than 10%, and then it's dissolved in the liquid surface uniformly. Before forming this polymer network, they should not be disturbed. Certainly, you can use all kinds of measures to create a unique structure. So after that, this polymer network can capture that liquid crystal orientation before forming this polymer network. In the cells, in a liquid crystal device, you normally require some kind of a surface alignment. And this surface alignment can be prepared by general methods. You have a glass substrate. You have glass substrates, and then you're talking about the thin layers of this polymer, for example, nylon polyimides. And then after that, after you bake, you remove the solvent, then you you actually rub, or in some cases, you may want to use a homotropic polymer that the polyimide that gives you the homotropic alignment. And in that case, that you may also want to have a lightly buff the surface to create some kind of a degeneracy in anisotropy on one surface. And then in general, planar cells, whatever we call it, is a homogeneous cell. If after you buff them, you have this anti-pair in the assembled substrates in an anti-pair fashion. For example, on the top substrate, you have the rubbing direction on, towards the left, and the bottom substrate towards the right. So make them 180 degrees. Because when you rub the surface, right, you create some kind of undulation on the surface. So there's a tendency of this anisotropy generate with the prettier angles. Means the liquid crystal molecules will no longer stay flat. They might be tilting away from the surface. So it depends on how hard the rubbing strength that you create on the surface layer. And so that's important that you control the orientation. In some cases, if you assemble this rubbing direction in the rubbing direction in the same direction, it's 0 degree. You can create some kind of so-called these tight cells. So that in that case, that liquid crystal will form a splay deformation within the cells. The next step is shine a light onto these cells, and then certainly the curing conditions is very important. The UV intensity, concentration of component, curing temperatures, certainly the mesophase of liquid crystal host. If you have a cholesteric, then normally they form these helical structures. If you have a ferroelectric, you may form a layer structure or this bookshelf texture, even chevron texture. That's very interesting, unique. In the blue phase, later on, in the second lecture, I'll show you that in the blue phase, they will form the cubic-like structures. So after that, you remove these liquid crystals, and you can see that if the polymer, the morphology of polymer follow the liquid crystal orientation. So in this case, that you can see the growth of spatially ordered polymer. First of all, because of the system, the free energy of the system includes the elastic energy of liquid crystal, which is the dominant factor, and then there's the free energy of the surface. In addition to that, the free energy of mixing, as we say that this is kind of equilibrium state. It's a uniform system, so this term is kind of a minimum. The contribution mostly coming from this elastic system of the liquid crystal, and then also the surface term with this polar anchoring and then mesophase anchoring. So it depends on how well aligned in the plane or out of the plane. And that controls that liquid crystals the polymer fiber formation direction. And the mixing term certainly this is a kind of a Fromer-Hawkins equations that in general it's controlled by temperature, so that's KVT. As long as we control these temperatures, and then we will be able to reproduce in this type of orientation. So here are a few examples. One is that you can see if we just have a planar rubbing orientation, in this case, under the cross polarizers, you can see that the rubbing direction, and then it shows that white and black line. Actually, those dark lines is because of the polymer network when it grows. there's no preferential orientation. So that's why under the cross horizons, even orient in 45 degrees, I think it is still showing the dark image. Once you remove those liquid crystals, you can see that if we kind of rotate that orientation 45 degrees from this cross horizons, you can see that the image changed to a dark image, but still you can see some kind of bright lines or bright dots, but with orientation. That's because of some of the liquid crystal get trapped inside of this polymer. And once we remove that, you can see that very uniform all the orientation of polymer fibers with the direction parallel to this substrate liquid crystal orientation direction. So we take a look at this cross section. You can see that the cross section with the cell is about 10 micron. And then this polymer can be uniformly linked from the top to the bottom substrates. So we want to study the parameters. If you're interested in this type of research, then you certainly would like to know that what kind of parameters control the formation of this type of polymer network. And first thing is this polymer concentration. It means reactive monomers, how much you put in the system, and what type, what kind of composition are you used. Okay? You can see that in some cases, the distance of those polymer walls or polymer fibers, you can see the distance of this. What controls those? So let's take a look. Well, first factor is if we have some kind of a polymer concentration gradient, and in the case of that, if we gradually increase the polymer concentration, somewhat is saturated once you reach about 3%. Okay, so 3% polymer, the distance kind of shortened from very far away to roughly around 50 microns in distance in space. And in the second factor that we study here is the photoinitiator concentration. The photoinitiator concentration means that once we shine the light on this system, it produced a certain amount of these free radicals. So the population is very important. If you have too much in terms of the ratio between monomer and photoinitiators exceeds to some certain critical concentration, and you may have a very dense, highly dense, tightly linked polymer network. And in those cases, you might create a very small voids, space for liquid crystal to fill into those space. And then the orientation is tightly controlled, so they will not be orient very well. In that case, you may create a lot of this light scattering in the system. So the distance wise, in terms of if we have a 1% of this polarization concentration, the space between those polymer fibers is roughly around 70 micron, and it can be reduced to roughly around one half of those distance when you increase from 1% to 4% concentration. The next factors we want to see is UV light intensity. Certainly, wavelength is the same kind of factor, right? Because of the energy of the light and the electromagnetic wave that impose on this system, it's the same thing. If you control the UV intensity of the system, you can see that it drops very quickly from sample that is roughly very low intensity to exceed slightly, and then to next level, roughly around 0.2 milliwatts per cent square meter, and then it leveled off. So in this case, this polymer concentration, monomer concentration, photoinitiator concentration are kept at the same. Certainly the temperature, the KPT, has kept the same at the room temperature. So you can see that the system distance of those polymer fibers leveled off from roughly around 85 micron to about 40 microns with just slightly increase of this photoinitiator concentration. Light intensity, sorry for that. So If all those, all those three parameters we kept at constant, and then the next thing is we change the temperature of the polarization system. And you can see that once we slightly increase the temperature, you can see that the distance of those fibers will vary, and then it increased. This is due to the viscosity of the system in order to decrease the diffusion length of those free radicals to find the active chain end. They have more opportunity to run a further distance. So slightly increase in terms of this fibers formation. So here is just a summary. We have a pneumatic liquid crystals of different type, and then all of the pneumatic liquid crystals has different kinds of physical properties. For example, they have roughly around optical variance around 0.14 to double of that to 0.286. The direction and subtlety of those systems is very low to very high. In this case, this kind of physical property does not matter too much. It's the orientation of the liquid crystals. So in general, roughly there, the cell gap is also plays a role. You see that the thin cell gap, the distance roughly for those fibers formation between 15 to 30. And then in the case of a thick sample, you have this diffusion length that increase. So with that, the fiber formation is slightly increased. And that observed for both cases, regardless of the type of liquid crystals. So in the electro-optics of this device, if you apply electric field, and then as a function of polymer concentration, the switch of voltage and also apply the voltage, you can see that it starts from 1 volt per micron, 1 volt for the system, to roughly increase when polymer concentration increase to about 5 or 6 volts. So the polymer concentration plays a role for those liquid crystals molecular reorientation. In the second case, the polymer concentration increased, and then for different type of liquid crystals, and it is also observed the same kind of system. Once you increase the polymer concentration, the threshold voltage of the systems increased. So how do we define those threshold voltage of the system? Since this is a planar cells, we can use that generalized of two systems. One is a different type of liquid crystals that has a symmetric A phase at the room temperature. The other one has only pneumatic room temperature. You can see that the threshold voltage for two systems are slightly different. One is more like a monotonic increase. The other one is that linearly proportional to this polymer concentration. So kind of give a quick summary for those introductory information. What we learned here are these especially all the polymer walls are with equal distance depend on this order of the host and the phase separation condition. So first one, at high monomer concentration results in a smaller distance between polymer walls and smaller droplets, or in the case of you have high concentration of polymer. The second case is the anisotropy phase separation depends on the rate of phase separation. The distance between polymer walls increase with functionality, and also concentration of monomer. The performance of that certainly depends on the control of polymer morphology. So the next case is we want to learn first, in the basic, we learned how to create this anisotropy polymer. In the second case, we want to learn that how can we create anisotropy, this polymerization of phase separation, which means that we can densify those polymer formation on surface. You can see that in the case of a system, as described before, it contains of liquid crystals in the field with the blue color. And the circles of those reactive monomers, certainly the red dots represents those photoinitiators. So once you shine the light, either strong UV light or this particular selective wavelengths, And you can see that you can drive the system, the chemical, the chemical potential balance into one direction, and then the next is, so you can see that the polymer fibers can form on one first surface. So that depends on the orientation, either the planar alignment, the homogeneous alignment, or homotropic alignment. And you can create some kind of fibers that are perpendicular to the surface or parallel to the surface. Here's one example. So, in a cholesteric system, if you have this helix that is oriented originally not perpendicular to the substrate, by applying this small field, we can unwind in and deform that helix to make it parallel to the substrate. And those helix are forming in the vectors parallel to the substrates, but it's forming more in blue colors. Once you shine the light, we can make sure that this localized on both surfaces. And here is one example of those polymers when you are using in the cholesteric material. You can see that those periodical patterns form, we can see the enlargement of that. This is the 2-micron bar here. The scale of this bar is 2 micron. And the pitch of this material is about 0.3 micron. And you can see that those fibers now, instead of extending between two substrates, extended between the two substrates, now it lies on this surface with this periodical patterns formation. And this type of material can be used to drive this cholesteric liquid crystal to stabilize this this helix orientation and make this device become a flexoelectric device. So this type of device is very fast orientation. You can see that it can be switched from a dark state to bright state, and there's no need of this warm-up voltage. We go back to here. In the case of this before polarization, this type of liquid crystal deformation requires additional energy. So it requires that you apply this electric field to keep it, this orientation in that place. It is so-called is a warm-up voltage or threshold voltage, not really threshold. Actually, it's a warm-up voltage that you need to apply to hold it. It's called holding the voltage. Otherwise, you turn the field off. They go back to this planar alignment, planar textures, then you will see that the orientation of this helix is in the plane. And with a short pitch, this 0.5 micron pitch, it only reflects that yellow color. So, but in this case, with polymer surface polymer stabilization, you can see that the device can be switched from a dark state to the bright state and apply at least a pulse of this square wave at 1 kHz. And the voltage of that is roughly around 3.5 volts per micron. You can see that that's the applied voltage, this is the optical response. So the turn on, turn off, roughly around equally 100 microseconds. And so total the response time is roughly on off is for 200 microseconds. The idea is like this. Once you have in the off state, this helix is aligned in the direction parallel to the substrate. And the uniform helix orientation now in the off state is parallel to one of the polarizer. That's why you see the dark state. Once you apply the fields, it rotates, it shifts. So the fields are applied to this, and it induces a kind of flexoelectricity and rotate this helix in the direction that now is in between this cross polarizer, and depends on how high the field. You can do this rotation angles, it totally depends on applying the field. And how do they rotate from here to here? They can be can be clockwise or counterclockwise. It depends on the helix. It depends on this cholesteric material, the chirality, the helix. If you have a left-handed and right-handed, they will pay the opposite direction. So that's how they behave. Well, if you apply higher fields, you can unwind those helix instead of you rotate those helix, and you can unwind those helix to a magnetic-like structure in the direction parallel to the substrate. So in those cases, this kind of amplitude modulation So previous one is more like a phase modulation. That's where pretty fast. In the case of this unwinding nose helix, you can see that unwinding nose helix from this planar alignment to this homotropic alignment. And then certainly in this state is a dark state, pretty dark. However, that it requires additional energy to unwind those cholesteric materials because the viscosity of this system. So in this case, that you will require a higher switching voltage for unwinding those cholesteric. In general, the response time for those systems is roughly less than 4 milliseconds on off. So here is one example that you can apply this type of technology to use this device for switchable optical elements, you know, whatever you want to use, a switchable optical lens, a switchable diffraction gratings, or any other application. So the next section, what I'm going to tell you is, now we're going to use this type of technique to generate some kind of polymer fibers on the surface, and the same technique using the cell configuration that with interdigitate electrodes on the surface. And just like yesterday, I described that in the blue phase. So in this section, so that I will give you some background information about this the evolution of this technology, which is being used for if you buy an iPad. Any one of you have iPad, MacBook, MacBook Pro, your computer is using this type of technology called IPS LCDs. And right now, mostly they're made by one particular company's system. And since I don't get receive any promotion, advertisement fee, so I will not tell that company's name. So let's continue this. I show you what type of physical properties and electro-optical property with this type of system. And certainly you have to take a look at this transmission voltage curve and the transmission response time. And importantly, what is the role, right? You may want to ask yourself, what is the role the polymer can be used in improving this property? And then how about the energies of this molecular anchoring on the surface? Does that improve or does that reduce the magnetic crystal really rotate much faster? Well, the same picture that you saw earlier. So in this work, we focus on this improving the response time of implant switching LCD. So you can see that implant electrodes like this, on top of that substrate is on the glass. And apart from substrates, there's also additional IPOs with interdigitated electrodes. On top of that, we have a layer of polyimides just to fill the gap, to planarize it, and then to give you the orientation of different crystals on the surface. What, in addition to that, we have these small continuous dots that are in the nanoscale. We call them polymer nanofibers, and that's used to improve this surface anchoring. Why do we need to do that? You know, when you are switching the different crystal molecule, you turn on your notebook computer, while you're looking at that, you change the pictures, right? When you are not changing the pictures, the field is kept steady. So there's a capacitance under each pixel that holds that charge. And then so your image will stay. Once you change to the next page, and you see that you have to apply an electric field to rewrite those image. In those cases, you can see that in the off stage, this little bit of orientation in one direction depends on how you create this kind of orientation. In the on state, the active fields are applied to this system. But here, because you have interdigitated electrodes, and then you apply through the gap of this liquid crystal cells, so there's a Gaussian distribution of this electric fields between two electrodes across the cell thickness. So in that case, that you can create it off state and on state, so you got light passing through. Now you can see your image. The evolution of this type of technology starts in very early stage in 1996, less than 15 years ago. We call this, there's an invention called this implant fusion mold. And then the next stage in 1998, there's an improvement. It's called super IPS mold. That means there are some dead ends, you know, there's a dead zones, the wind angle is limited. So the creation of this super IPS is by using zigzag electrodes instead of straight electrode. Okay, certainly your fingers cannot zigzag, you have super natures, you know, you can zigzag your fingers. But those electrodes are kind of a zigzag. And then the next, in 2002, there's a further improvement called advanced, it's a super, it's a IPS mode, AS super IPS mode. And then in 2004, there's also additional improvement of IPS Pro mode. And then certainly right now, 2008, the Ultra IPS mode. And if you are able to create another one, you certainly can create it called super IPS mode. So it improves from original that it's a straight electrode line to this zigzag electrode to create multi-domain structure. The objective of this, there are two. The objectives are, first of all, if once you create this zigzag orientation, you can see that first, since it eliminated this coordination lines, the dark states are on top of the electric field. The second is because it creates a better viewing angles. Because if your eyes, if you have eyes stage, if you are the viewers looking down from here versus the other viewer looking down from here. In these pixels, you see the very minimum of this divergence, but in these two pixel positions, you see a very maximum. Okay? But if you reverse that position, now you see sensing. So it gives you the wide viewing angles characteristic. That has an advantage. That means that improves the color shift. The color shift that in the color chromaticity diagram, you can see that in the original state. It is slightly have some viewing angle limitation, and then in this zigzag electrode, it improves both. It also improves the better viewing angle, better color contrast. So you can see that super IPS mode to this two domains structure. The IPS probe that further improve this contrast ratios from this type of zigzag electrode to give a better fringe field effect. And this is called fringe field switching. Means it uses the double edge, either concave or convey type of fields distribution across the cell with the common electrodes on the bottom, and then you apply the electric field between this active electrode and the common electrode. So with that, you can see it further improve this light transmission. So this IPS Pro to this Ultra IPS even further improve this contrast ratio. Today you go to an electronic store, you can find out that they tell you from in the past 700 to 1, 1000 to 1, 3000 to 1. And right now they call this dynamic this contrast, median to 1. So that's the type of this technology improvement here. However, that still did not solve the problem of this response time issues, right? The color quality, the beam angle, and certainly the contrast ratio has been improved. The remaining issues related to this technology relies on this if they can switch faster. Let me ask you one question. Who has an iPad? How many of you who has an iPad? I have one. iPad allow you to rotate, if with any angles, the same quality of viewing quality. Have you ever seen that? Right? If you have iPad, you just keep rotating your screen. So what I mentioned here is that explains very well for your application, for your products that you use the iPad. The reason why you choose iPad instead of is vertical alignment. It's a vertical line, and there's some angle dependence of this wind angle in the 45 degree diagonal direction. You know, this IK rotation is pretty symmetric with additional wind angle compensation field, the optical foils to compensate those light leakage at the off angles, and then it gives you a very symmetric. So that's why you rotate this images without any limitation of viewing cones or viewing contrast of deterioration. That's one thing. But you know, why do you choose IPEC? Does anybody know why you choose IPEC? Why IPEC choose this IPS mode? That's the other issue. Most viewers are using IPEC. What do you do with IPEC? You use that for internet browsing. You mostly use that for movie, okay, and internet emails. You know, those kind of image does not require too complicated system design. So response time wise, current stage is is acceptable. If you say you are unacceptable, please raise your hand. Right? Certainly, until you have one. So those were the kind of the issues. Okay, the reason that Apple chose this iPad is because of good viewing angle cones and a very symmetric viewing angles in all direction. And you don't ask for too much, but like looking at the motion picture, you don't use iPad for your games application. So that's one thing, because of its implant fusion is a little bit slower. So the way to improve that is we're interested in to see that find out that if we can use the surface localized this polymer to improve the surface anchoring. So when you apply the electric field across, moving that liquid crystals away from the cross polarizers, right, from dark state to bright state, and return once they return to the dark state. This one, if you have a stall that increase its surface anchoring, and then it can relax back to its original orientation much faster. So that's the principle. Here is just a simple electrode in the left. Now we don't have this zigzag photo mask. It's pretty expensive. We have this straight line, either 5 microns, 7.5, or 10 microns lines and space. The light transmission, certainly, I think it's governed by this simple equation. It's a function of this orientation angles with respect to the cross polarizer. Retardation values, this height delta NV over this lambda, so whatever wavelength we are viewing. Certainly, this is white light, so you have to observe that for blue, green, and red. I make sure that they can cover that. So normally, they change it to yellow. So in this case, that means if you have this robbing direction, this is the kind of two electrodes, and then the robbing direction orientation, this angle is pretty important in this technology. So in the cross section, you can apply high field. In our case, we are not using this fringe field to do this study. But that's just another engineering aspect to improve that. So the basic is to see this metal polymer fibers, if they fall on the surface, can they improve this property? So here are the kind of material scheme that we use. You have 100% of liquid crystal, 0% of polymer, and then we raise your input from 0.2 to 0 to 0.2, 1.0 to 0.1, 3.1. And then the cell depth that we kept is the same, about 3.5 micron. So to make that is just like the cartoon that I showed you earlier, we kind of fill the cells with active electrodes, and then with one of these top substrates that does not have the electrodes. Then you shine the light, and then you certainly wish that this polymer will localize on the surface, not growing in between, that cause some light scattering. So with that, once it's formed in the off stage, we hopefully get also good dark state. The transmission is very important, so light transmission is a major issue. too much of the polymer, it's going to cause some of the light scattering, as we just show you. So we don't want this type of a bulk polymer. So once you control the polymer, there's also a possibility to form different type of orientation, like vertical alignment. In the second lecture, I talk about this type of approach. But in some of the previous work, you can see all kind of polymer nanofibers can be formed. In this case, we are saying that we started with 0% polymer, and that's the 0% polymer. You see that the square. This is the kind of normalized transmittance versus the applied voltage for all samples that we studied here. The square, it represents that 0% polymer, and so you can see that it starts from the dark state to the bright state. And then for 0.2%, the voltage transmission curve slightly increased. The V10 and V90 is the 10% light transmission. The voltage of 10% light transmission, and V90 is the voltage of the cell being switched to 90% transmission. You can see that both the V10 and V90, they increase towards higher voltage with the increase of polymer concentration, right? So this follows that the basic information that I just showed you in the first section, right? The first section I showed you that in any system, regardless they are either on the surface or in the ball, that polymer fibers are created, or even nanoparticles. If you put in yesterday I showed you that the ball nanoparticle, you put it in, you drop into this liquid crystal system. It increased the viscosity, and then so the systems increase. But in this case, that it caused some kind of a strong anchoring in the ball. In our case, we try to see if we have the polymer on the surface. Okay. So the next step, now we find out that the light transmission is roughly maintained. There's a very little negligible difference in light transmittance in those surface polymer. To assist this liquid crystal alignment. The switching voltage here, so I kind of replot that the V90, V10, and then V90, you can see that there's a trend to increase from lower voltage to higher voltage, both of them slightly increase, so that observed the previous one. In the response time, that's the important issue we want to learn. You can see that in the turn-on voltage, depends on how much of the polymer you have. I think the turn-on voltage is less dependent. But there's an improvement. You can see that this square, dark square, is the 0% polymer. It takes a while to return to this dark state. It exceeds 50 milliseconds. So that's very slow. But in your IP application, that's not a major issue. What they can do is they use electronic methods to drive it faster to roughly around 10 milliseconds. So in this case, we have a polymer 0.2%. You can see that the dark state stabilization process is getting improved. Further improved is 1% and 3% is much faster. So here is the plot for those response time. For the right response time, this is dark line here. With 0%, and then there's a slight insignificant increase of improvements in the right side. But this depends on how high of the voltage that you apply, so that's insignificant. In the fourth time, you can see that there's a dramatic improvements in the four times. Once you reach some polymer concentration at about 1% on the surface, right? So you may also want to ask me, prove it, right? You say you have surface polymers on the surface. And that turn-on voltage is governed by this equation. All of them, they are all related to associate with this rotational viscosity of the liquid crystal molecules, and certainly inversely proportional to the directional isotropy of the system. And you apply the electric fields. So the turn-on voltage is 3%, in this case about 6.4 milliseconds. So here is one example. The cartoon on the left that shows you that with polymers, fibers, in this case they are not kind of interlink. This is 0.2% polymer with a 5 micron electrode line, and then a 5 micron space between the electrodes. Then the cell gap was 3.45 micron. You can see that this polymer fiber is about 0.1 to 3 micron in length. In terms of the length here, this is the bar here is the scale bar here is a 1 micron. So the width of this fiber is roughly around 50 to 100 nanometers, and then a few tens of nanometers in height. So the polymer fiber show the preferential orientation following the robbing direction. You can see that this is the robbing direction. So they all have a preferential orientation. The appearance of these fibers depends on the phase separation condition. So we want to see that, you see, this is the top substrate, this is the upper substrate, this is the bottom substrate. Remember that the cells that I showed you earlier, right? The bottom substrate, the lower substrate has this is the light incident side, this is the opposite side. So there's a difference in terms of the amount and the quantity. So once we show this 3% polymer, you can see that this is the cross section. Okay, you see those two beads. This bead size is about roughly this is 1 micron, but this is 3.45 micron spaces to keep the cell gap uniform. That cell gap, you see that nothing grows in between. There's no polymer fibers only on the surface. Once we increase to 3% of polymer, you can see that the length roughly is kept kind of uniform between 0.1 to 3 micron, and then the width, roughly the size they increase, there's a few tens of nanometers in height. So this one increased that concentration, and then that followed the previous introduction section. So let's compare those polymer, those samples with 0.2% polymer, 1% polymer, and then 3% polymer. Once you reach to some extent, you see that 5% polymer, the polymer fibers grow very, very long, okay? Longer than expected. But still, the size, the width, the diameters you know, is still much less than 200 nanometer. Well, in some cases, if you form this polymer fiber, you analyze detail. Those were some areas like the spacer, you can see that the spacers, right? And also the size here. And there are some regions that are on the electrode surface and then and in between the pixels. You know, there are some different kind of density localization. You see that this is very similar to your spaghetti that you have for lunch or dinner. But in some areas, it's less dense in between. So what causes this? This is some of the regions that electrode region and blocking some of the light. This is some of the pixel areas that have more light passing through. So in that case, that you know, this formation of that is also driven by the light intensity. So that's part of that introduction information. Certainly, you like to know that if we improve this surface anchoring or not. There's a way to do it. Certainly, you need to measure that what is the transmutual anchoring strength. And then to do that, there are multiple, many ways to do it. Here's one of the examples that shows that you can use the top balance measures to study that. Just see the ECX rotation of this direct orientation of liquid crystal with respect to your cross polarizers, and then with that you can use the multiple lines equations to calculate that anchoring energy, and then just to see that how those liquid crystal direct orientation that ECX follow that apply the field orientation, and then you can determine that this is a mutual anchoring energy. So I will not go through that in detail. I just show you that you can see that with the increase in polymer concentration here, this is the anchoring energy in joule per meter squared. So you can see that it slightly increased from about 4 folds in terms of a higher polymer concentration, which 1%, it also increased significantly. So that increase in surface energy will help. But in the case of you want to create multi-domain structure, okay? Right now the industry has most panel made with these are two domain. They would like to increase up to 8 domains. What does that mean? They slice those pixels, the regions into 8 of them. So they want to either save the cost of the optical compensation beams, the wide beam angle beams, to compensate those light leakage in the off angle. So if that's possible, then the way to do it is when you align this liquid crystal molecule in the zero state, then you create a multiple orientations within one pixel. When you see that as these pixels get turned on and off, now at all beam angles, then you can have the same kind of optical contrast. So that's the objective. So here, in order to achieve that, we also study that we form this polymer network with applied electric field. You can see that applied electric fields, it shows a slightly different from previous one. When you apply electric field, the threshold voltage and also the turn-on voltage here, this one, the red one, the red color one, the round one, is the one which applies the voltage. You can see that the threshold, both threshold and the turn-on voltage is decreased. But the trade-off here is their response time is not as good as the others, so we will have to take a look inside of the cell. You see, this is the image. It shows that with applied electric field, it creates multi-domain, and then the response time is slightly worse than what we expected. So we want to know what's going on here. What's going on here is the electrode regions, right? This is the pixel region. So in that case, that you can see, this is the Raman direction. These pixel regions are once you apply field. You see the orientation, okay? What caused the increase in response time? It's because of this. You see that the fiber orientation now are oriented in the orthogonal direction with respect to the applied field. So I guess that's kind of information we learned here, okay? So here I will stop for this lecture over here to answer your question. So the conclusion is, what are the features for this type of technology? The features are a fast switching surface polymer that can assist this liquid crystal orientation in the zero field state. It's a controllable size, density, preferential orientation of light in bus this surface localized polymer fibers. What are the benefits? The benefits include the fast response due to this increase surface angle strength, same kind of light transmission, not very very low loss in terms of compared to non-polymer samples. But certainly it's not perfect, right? But the last one I just showed you that maybe it requires these zigzag electrodes for the interdigitated electrode. Once you apply the field on and off, it's roughly going closely to 90 degrees. So the fiber forming in this direction, cross section. That's why they don't know, now they get confused, right? Turn off state, now they get confused. And that's the reason that they have more work to do. So I guess that, with this, I stop right here to answer your question. Thank you.
Some of the polyimide side chains with a particular length, they increase reduce the surface energy once you have side chain, right? So that liquid crystal can be tilted up a little bit higher. So that's the way to do to control the preview angle in the polar direction, polar angle.
Switching and you polymerize in the field, right? You get these, you get, you know, two sets of fibers, one along the rubbing and the last slide you were showing, this one, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, this is because of, at zero voltage, you know, then you have one orientation, right? The liquid crystals follow that rubbing direction. When you apply fields, it orients in the direction parallel to the field, right? So that direction close to 90 degrees. That's why I show here that the orientation roughly get disrupted. But what does that tell us? That tells you that while this polymer fiber formation, right? While you shining the lights on this system, and you are applying field, that kilohertz, 1 kilohertz, that liquid crystal rotates pretty fast, right? And with that, still that nucleation grows the persistent length of these polymers. That also polymer fibers grows also follow up that orientation. So sometimes in the milliseconds region or sub millisecond region, they still can continue to nucleate grow those polymer fibers in that direction. Okay. I did not calculate
very well. Some of those, you see some of fibers growing that way, some of this way, some
right.
of that way. Did you see that?
But the field is going this way, isn't it? Is it horizontal?
Horizontal? Some of them, that's right. When they could, it could form at any stage, right? During the switching.
Okay, well, one thing I was going to just mention is that if it is an elastic thing, right, while it's growing, if the dielectric constant of the fibers is lower than the liquid crystal, which could be the case, that's very common for polymer networks in liquid crystals, right? That it would tend the electrostatically would want to align perpendicular to the field direction. So that, but I might be completely confused about what this slide showing. We'll talk.
Well, I did not catch your question very well, but I can talk to you later. This the dielectric constant of this polymer once it's formed on the network is pretty low, roughly around 2 to 3.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. For liquid crystal, generally around 6, 10. Yeah, or 12.
Right.
But in those cases, if you try to say will this cause some kind of an image sticking? Which is one of the important issues. If you turn the display, right, there's a ghost shadows. Well, those kind of means there's a kind of a residual DC voltage left over. That's related to the ions radicals that you generate still floating around in the system, that disrupting that effective fields across the electrodes. But in this case, I think it's a bit since 0.2%. Those materials causing that issues is low. I also have some dielectric measurements with this. Okay, but I can tell you more. If you'd like to learn more. Any other question?
Yes, so let's just do this. If you have any issues with scattering, presence of polymer network, is it an issue?
In this case, that's a good question too, but that associated with that is you can see that even with applied field, this light intensity is roughly about the same as the transmissions. So very minimum, as I told you earlier, right? You create polymer network, but this is in plane orientation.
Mm-hmm.
If you create polymer network in the plane, then you have a light scattering.
know, because of the indices of refraction, they are not mentioned, you know, in at some particular state, either on state or off state. So you may have a light scape and you lost the contrast of these pixels. Yeah, that's
a. Do you have some matching of indices played in such a way that you minimize those issues?
They're very small too.
I think for those nano scales fibers, they are very they are about 100 nanometers. You know, it's smaller than the wavelength of light. You know, it doesn't scale too much. You know, but the density, okay, the density is one issue. That's why I show you the scope. You know, the range of this polymer concentration, once it grows to 5%, you see the spaghetti like long fibers, you know, and the density is kind of increased. And in that case, this one will have a more profound effect on the vertical alignment. So the next lecture, I tell you that the vertical alignment, and that caused some more severe problems than this. That's what Vladimir did work, the earlier work. But we also improve that. Okay, any other question? If no, I thank you very much.